We're making this continued call to sobriety of mind because the times call for them. We're in extreme, extreme times right now. Those who have suffered really terribly, they're the ones that are willing to put the work in. And those are the happy-go-lucky, carefree, life's a cabaret, you know, that they're not willing to put the time in. Maybe a couple minutes, that's enough. On to the next distraction. So Jesus said he came to save the poor in spirit. Now, those who have really suffered, they're the ones who are willing to put the time in and get into the sober mood. When you get into the sober mood, you are sort of, the world becomes diffuse and you're not so interested in it. You're not thinking about this and this and this and this and this about the world, right? You're all that's diffuse, like back, it's gone back into the shadows. And you are able to let an idea bloom in your mind at that point and see it and notice it and say, and smell the fragrance of it. So if there was ever a time in history of this planet where we need to practice this sobriety, it's right now. So I keep on taping. And it's every video is a call to this sobriety. And it will pay off. It will pay off. Those are the ones that will escape. This morning, as I was sort of going in and out of dozing, I saw something perceptually, which was quite extraordinary. I seemed to see no thing, the essence of no thingness. Perceived it. I was perceiving the absence of thingness. There is a thing there, and then I perceived its absence. But it wasn't like I wasn't perceiving. Had no perception at all. There was this like the perception of emptiness or something. And it just happened. I said, what was that? How can I see nothing? No thingness. But apparently we can. We have this grace of perception that is able to see the, I guess they call it the essential emptiness of everything. That we're able to actually perceive that. So see, that's a quite a, you know, these things percolate up. They percolate up and they're not inconsequential. When you actually put in the time to get familiar with this and able to get your concentration here and your attention, then this progress is made. So now that's got my attention, you see, and say, hey, it is possible. I just did it. I just saw it. It's like seeing nothing, as it were, but still with a form, like a very subtle form. As I said, all perception is actually illusion. It's all imagination, it's all hallucination, all of it. So it doesn't matter what you hallucinate, none of it's real. So you might as well hallucinate something that reminds you of reality. It's totally pragmatic. Totally pragmatic. The Holy Spirit is totally pragmatic. The resolution is totally pragmatic. Again, all perception is a hallucination. It's a hallucination. We're simply imagining that reality is conforming to whim, which the whim would say there's something prior to reality. And the whim is prior to the reality. And then the whim has mind dream up this scenario where it says that it looks like reality either is conforming or has conformed, but there's this farce that we call nature that is conforming to a whim. All this thingness, it's just nature. What is nature? It's impermanence. It's an illusion, really. It's an illusion that there's some permanence here. There isn't anything that's permanent in nature. There's no permanence. Anyway, so it's a dream. It's our own desire. It's a projection of our desire, really. And I've said that there are two types in the world, and those, you know, those who project and don't see it, and those who are willing to work on their own projections. Those are the extreme difference between the two, actually, going in different directions. Projection is to have something within you that you don't want within you, and you refuse to recognize and say, whoa, no, that's not within me, I don't have that. And then to project it out externally and say, it's out there. And then you feel like momentarily you feel, oh, I feel better because it's coming from out there. So it gives a kind of temporary sort of, you know, marginal type of relief type of thing. And that's why it seems magical. And the ego stock and trade is projection. That's it. All of this is projection. All our problems come from projection. And the only problem we really have is the continuity problem, because we're so used to this play of impermanence, perception of what we think are things, that we're afraid to set perception down. That's it. So there's this intermediate step that we have, and we have to continually focus on this intermediate step. The resolution to the continuity problem is, again, the only issue there is, and that enables one to focus in. When I say make the world diffuse, be sober, that's how you do it. That's how you do it. Hey, cat. I'm in the cat's seat. Maybe I'm the catbird seat. He says, hey, this is my time to sit here. What are you doing here? Right? It becomes diffuse when you realize that the continuity problem is the only problem there is. Therefore, you don't need to be thinking about all this stuff. You know, you don't need to be thinking about all this terrible stuff in the world, like the typhoon in the Philippines, etc. Because really, if not for the continuity problem, we would drop this hallucination altogether instantly. There would be no typhoon anywhere. There'd be no Philippines. There'd be world. There'd be none of that. Nothing of that order at all. And what there would be, we cannot explain verbally. We have to be reminded of it. That's the only way. Okay? We can never get an idea of what reality is like through externals of any type. Never. Only through the reminder which grace provides can we begin to remember what reality is. It's the only way. So those who pursue this path of thinking that, you know, externally they can be reminded externally, it's not possible. Not through words, not through art, not through music, not through dance, not through anything whatsoever can you be reminded of what reality is. So the whole goal is to accept this resolution to the continuity problem, which reminds us of what reality is like. Otherwise, we'll be too afraid to drop perception, and we're stuck. We're stuck. And then we will project, because really what happens is, when we're afraid of dropping perception, afraid of being aware of what reality, what happens is that desire, the attraction to reality is within us, within our mind, within our spirit. It's always there, but we're so scared of this attraction that we are frantic to deny that it's there. Because it seems like we can't control it when it's central to us. So we project it outwards. We project it and say, no, it's not coming for me. I don't have any such desire, and I don't want to. It's those out there that have it. They're the bad ones. They're the ones that are scaring me. That's not true. We're being scared by our own attraction to reality, because we don't know, we're fear of this continuity problem. So the way, if you want peace in the world, if you want to end all this conflict, the only way is to focus on the continuity issue and the resolution of it and accept it for yourself. That's the only way. And that is why I say the world's in a very bad shape, because it is not pursuing this way at all. It's pursuing the opposite. It's avoiding this to an unprecedented extent that cannot end well. It cannot end well at all. it's doubling down. You keep doubling down and doubling down, and at some point, wow, look out. We think the world, oh, everything's fine, right? Yeah, well, tomorrow you could read the newspaper or internet or whatever, the news, and it says, scientists have, there's alarming reports of some new respiratory illness that's broken out in, you know, the frontier provinces somewhere. And right now, it seems to be transmitted from human to human, and we're rushing to contain it. We don't know how bad it is, blah, 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 blah. You know, the next thing you know, there's this contagion that is spreading, right? I mean, you just wake up one morning and suddenly you get the news. So, it's not good. It's not the way. The way of the world is not the way. The world is so wrapped up in projection now that its goal is to get rid of those who are aware of how to resolve the continuity problem. Because they're so uneducated, so ignorant of it, of this, that all they can do is turn to projection and say, oh, this is a dangerous, threatening, terrible thing, and it's not coming from me at all. It's coming from, you know, coming from those who are religious or spiritual, who, you know, they're the bad ones. We need to purge the world of them, get rid of them. Already, you know, they're put on ignore by most of the world. Put on ignore. That's the goal. The goal of the world is to get rid of all teachers who actually can help. As if, then if there's no help, somehow everyone's going to be happy. No, because the attraction to reality remains within everyone. So what happens is wars start. Projection gets so bad, builds up so strongly, that you feel that you finally assign a scapegoat and say they are causing this extreme discomfort, and we have to get rid of them. And of course, they look at you and say, feel the same thing. You're the one who's causing my extreme discomfort. And then you have conflict. Whereas if you're aware of this whole situation, you focused on the continuity issue, resolving it, you're not projecting. You say, no, it's my desire. And you have the same desire. And we don't need to project on one another at all. There's no conflict like that. It doesn't build up. There's petty things arise, you know, but you don't have this intense doubling down sort of situation at all. So we're setting the context for the world right now. It's a dangerous place because of this doubling down on projection, which seems to bring about temporary happiness, because people are relieved. They say, oh, I really don't have it within me. I don't have this problem. I don't have a continuity problem. Ah, because the ego tells us that we can make perception permanent, make this whole thing permanent, and therefore we never have to go back to reality. So what the ego says, just project out on others. You'll feel that you don't have it within you. You'll get this sense of relief, and then later on we'll find a way to make perception permanent. Problem solved. You know. So that's what happens. And then when this desire for reality comes back, people are getting all jittery, and the ego says, don't worry, just double down, just a little longer, and to double down pushes it in the future. We'll make perception permanent, everything will be fine, we're almost there. And this doubling down process continues on and on and on and on and on. You see, that's the ego. That's the path of the world, simply continually pushing it into the future, doubling down and projecting, and a momentary relief, like, oh, I don't have any attraction to reality, so I don't have to worry about going back, so I don't have a continuity issue, so I can just enjoy this world. Everything's fine. And then it creeps back in. You say, what is that? What is that feeling? And then you say, somebody's trying to, you know, mess with me. Like that. You don't own it. You don't own it. People here refuse to own. They're even, you know, saying, there is no God. All religion is insanity. These people are extreme projectionists, extreme egotists, extreme doubling down, terrified, and also very lazy. They're greedy for the world, doing more and more and more and more and more to try to calm them down. More and more drugs do to calm them down. Projection leads to drugs, as a matter of fact. It absolutely does. Because once you project and say my desire to return to reality, to drop this hallucination, I don't have it, it's out there, then you say, I gotta feel happy because I'm afraid somehow it might creep back into me somehow. So you take drugs, and say, hey, I feel great, I feel fine, you know, I'm happy. But within you say, feel this sense of like, I'm not really happy. There's something I want, I can't get it. And then you get really worried, and then project more, and then more drugs to fill this, you know, to keep you feeling happy. It's a vicious, vicious circle, which is now why we have this huge movement in the world to legalize drugs. Guaranteed, that's where the world's going. I said this long ago. Guaranteed that this is where we're headed. We're headed towards a pharmacological planet. Planet Pharma. You might call this world not Planet Gaia. You can call it that too, but you can call it Planet Pharma. We're going toward a hedonism too. Hedonism. Licentiousness. Anything goes. Pharma, licentiousness, everything. Desperately trying to stave off the return of this attraction to reality. And so, you know, many people have gone through this in their own personal lives, actually. And so they know exactly what was being shared here. But we're doing it on a global scale right now, which is terrible, because there's no breaks. There's no breaks, really. This is the end of the age that has been foretold. The pit of the Kali Yuga, the end of the age, where this projectional hedonism, Planet Pharma thing takes place. Because if you realize your attraction to reality and what it is, you know everyone has exactly the same. So there's universal compassion is what happens then. You know everybody's going through, you know, has the same dynamic of, oh my gosh, I'm attracted to reality, I have this continuity problem, what do I do? Everybody's in the same boat, everyone. It's just that the ego whispers in our ear and tells us the remedy, and it's false. It makes things worse. It's kind of like getting up with a hangover and then the ego says, hey, start drinking again, that'll cure the hangover. That's, you know, I mean, alcoholics know that very well. That's what the ego tells you. It says, hey, double down. If you feel terrible, take another drink. All drug addicts know exactly what this is like. And then eventually they bottom out so bad, they say, my God, I need help. They turn to the Holy Spirit and the grace of God, which is the resolution, the continuity problem. There is a way, and which is what we focus in on. In these videos, we're focusing in on that that which reminds us of reality, which is an inner experience, is a perceptual experience. And we have to prepare for it. We have to understand the context of it so that it can blossom. It's like a flower, a plant, and we need to fertilize it, water it, give it, you know, sunlight, and protect it from bugs and all that stuff, and then eventually it grows and the flower blooms. And then you have this perceptual vision which reminds you of reality. So this is really the work. The work is to continually look at the continuity problem and the resolution to it, and forget about the other stuff. Forget about the other stuff. It's irrelevant. Dangerously irrelevant, as a matter of fact. So you wonder, what have people been doing for, you know, in caves in Tibet for, you know, so long in various places? They are working towards that, accepting the resolution of the continuity problem. That's what they're working on. They may say it in different terminologies, etc., but we're using the terminology of the day right here, right now. So that's what they're doing. That's what they're doing. Or should be doing. They're not out trying to solve the problems of the world.
I
to my mom. People said, you're not doing enough, not doing enough. And those who came here said, you know what? The hospital, we'll make a hospital in your name. And we'll name it, you know, the name it after you. And people say, oh, good, good, good. She's actually doing something to help the world. It's like that. We'll build some buildings and, you know, charitable works. We've got to, you know, come on, we got to make this world livable. So we want to be here. That's projection. It's saying, I'm too afraid of a continuity issue. I don't think it can be solved. Therefore, I need to make this world feel like home to me because I feel like that's the answer. So we need this to, you know, take care of people and make this a happier place. Fear of the continuity issue. And the guru just sits there quietly. And we don't understand what's going on. Where's our marching orders? Where can we build the hospital? I read an article, or came across an article, about this man who was a hunter, fell from a tree, was paralyzed from the neck down, and that very day they said, you're never going to be able to function again. He said, okay, pull me. He couldn't breathe on his own at that point. And he said, okay, pull me off life support. He decided he's going to end his life right then because he can't have the lifestyle that he wanted. I said, what? You know, what foolish advice. He was listening to his own, the ego, because he was like, he could have spent, you know, years and years, decades in contemplation. His mind was still fine. And he could have actually accepted the vision of no-thingness, the effortless equilibrium, the grace of God. He could have used that as a perfect opportunity instead. Pull the plug. That shows you the mood of the times. That shows you the mood. That wouldn't have happened in the past. It shows you the mood of the times. If people don't get their instant gratification, they're willing to pull the plug on themselves. So, it's like, wow, that really struck me. Even those who are in comas, they're just not able to communicate with the world, but in their mind, within, they can be literally working on all this clarification process. Anybody can. The crippled, the lame, all those people can do that. Even the sick people can. So it's not about making excuses, it's about doing it. And people, you know, a lot of the suffering world is people's projections and saying, I'm so scared of reality, I need an excuse to say that I can't focus on this issue. So all these excuses arise, all these troubles arise in their life, and they never have an opportunity to focus in on it. Now, you know, how is it that I'm able to focus in on this? Because somehow everything has come together, works together such that I'm in a situation where I can. You know, there's no excuses. In fact, it's custom set up customly somehow. Those who don't want to work on it, somehow their lives always provide an excuse not to. And those who do want to work on it, somehow their lives provide the opportunity to do so. That's not by chance. So we keep practicing this sobriety of mind here. Not trying to force anything on anyone, like get into the heart now, you know, come on, let's do it. No, it's subtler than that. It's this focus on the continuity issue and the diffusion of everything else. So when the remedy comes, you can then just say, a beautiful flower has bloomed. That's exactly the flower that I wanted. And just accept it. Like I said, again, this morning, my perception for an instant, saw the absence of perception, you might say. It's like perceiving the absence of perception. I was quite surprised. And that's because there's this focus, you see, this focus, and the other stuff is diffuse, and you have to practice it. It's not an intellectual answer like you get in a classroom where, you know, okay, what's the answer to this mathematical equation? Oh, I got it, it's right here, da, da, da. Oh, okay, done. It's not a task that you accomplish. Do it, okay, I did this task. Those who are afraid of the continuity issue love having all sorts of tasks to do. Accounting, counting numbers, all this kind of stuff. Occupying their brain, the mind, constantly categorizing, adding up, you know. They're obsessive compulsive, you know, that they have to, you know, count stuff just so they can avoid this diffuseness where clarity begins to arise. They don't allow any sunlight to hit that plant. They don't allow any water fertilizer to hit it. They're constantly, you know, protected. They say, no, don't give that plant any nurturing whatsoever. Don't, because they're too afraid. Ignorance. Ignorance of this is not bliss, that is for sure. So familiarity comes about through constantly focusing on it and actually doing it. No answer, no question. Now, see, the origin of his problem is Wim thought that it posed a question to reality, that somehow it was questioning reality, and reality has been challenged. Wim has decided to challenge reality. Now, reality has never been challenged. There is no question, there's no questioning of it. It's a complete presumption on the part of spirit, of this Wim, that, so, there isn't any response from reality to Wim. But because of the continuity problem, God created a special creation of spirit, a special blessing upon spirit to deal with the continuity problem. But that's it. That's it. Nothing else. So when the realization of this perception, seeing no perception, comes, which reminds us of reality, people will ask questions. But what they're really saying is, I'm prior to whatever you're talking about. I'm prior to that. I'm prior to that. That reminds me of some teachers, questionable teachers maybe, that their technique is to always say, Whatever realization you have, you know, you say, yeah, but there's something prior to that, you know, prior to that. It's a one-upmanship sort of thing. But keep in mind that the only goal of the spiritual path is to accept the resolution of the continuity problem. That's it. So if someone says, well, there's something prior to that or whatever, that's neither here nor there. Because you'll never get to reality unless you first have the continuity problem solved. So there is some spiritual gamesmanship going on in the world. There's no question about that. But this just simply has to be ignored. When you get this vision, the vision of equal vision of equilibrium, effortless equilibrium, the vision of the overlay, the vision of oneness, the vision, a vision of no thingness, the vision of emptiness, perception, seeing no perception. When you get that, that's it. That's it. There's nothing more than that. As far as you're concerned, there's nothing more than that, because God takes the final step. itself, the prime creator itself, takes the final step. So that's it. There's nothing more than that. There isn't something prior to that, or more than that, or deeper than that. No, that's it. That's it. Because the ego plays this game. The ego wants to get you off of that vision at all costs. So what it will do is say, hey, that's great. You finally had that vision. Okay, good. Now, go a little deeper. And then, of course, you drop. Oh, deeper. And you drop it. That's the trick of the ego. A lot of this, you know, in-depth stuff, go deeper, is the ego. It's the ego tricking us. Because it'll congratulate us and say, okay, that's great. You've gone this far, but don't stop there. You know, there's a lot more, a lot greater depth. You need to get in that greater depth. No, you don't. You do not at all. There isn't any greater depth, because remembrance of reality is the only remedy there is. You've taken the exact right prescription. Because reality, again, is can never be reminded through all this play of impermanence as it is. We have to have this vision of perfect equilibrium of perception, of no perception, perception of no thingness, which is steady, all-inclusive, no accumulation, more here, less there, seamless. We have to abide in that, simply abide in that, that's all. Don't try to go deeper. There is no deeper to that remedy. It's a trick of the ego to say go deeper. So there are these gurus who trick people that way, and they make them feel perpetually insecure, because no matter what realization, you may have this realization, they'll say, ah, yes, 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 okay, okay, now, how does that feel? And they'll say, okay, yeah, sure, that's a nice step you've taken, it's great. Okay, now let's, you know, now let's go on to the next step. And then you suddenly feel, what? And what next step? I mean, yeah, you know, oh, I got to work on externals now, you know, to integrate it and all this stuff. And then you fall, you know, then the guru seems to be, these fake gurus seem to be higher than you, and you're insecure in relationship to them. And that's the trick, that's the game they play. Simply abide in this vision of effortless equilibrium, effortless equanimity. It's a perceptual thing. And of course, you know there's something beyond perception, but the goal is to drop perception altogether, and you will only do that when you are, after you've abided in this vision for quite some time. It's up to God. When you're ready, God will know. So the guru's goal is to get you to this vision. That's the guru's goal, the real goal. Once you've done that, just abide in it. That's it. Nothing more. There is nothing more than that. So people are practicing all these subtle perceptions and all the subtlety and stuff, and wasting their time, and they say, oh no, this is beyond this, you know, emptiness. It's even beyond that. We're working all this other stuff. They're missing the boat. They're missing the boat. They never wake up. It's an egoic trick. I've always said the ego sponsors the majority of spiritual practices. It's sponsored by the ego, actually. You don't need them. The ego will infer that you're kind of dumb. You say, well, yeah, you've made some progress there, but if you're really smart, you'd realize there's a lot more to go. There's a higher state than that. And then you kind of look down on, right? You've seen these gurus, and this whole thing of looking down on those who have stuck there. You're stuck. You're stuck. You're not accepting the guru's grace in full, you know. That's a scam. That's a scam. That is a scam. There's some very clever scam artists that have masqueraded as gurus. They'll say you're stuck. And then you're dumb. And then they tell everyone else to look down at you like, ah, poor so-and-so. They're they're just stupid. You know, they're stupid. They get bullied, you know, you get bullied and things like that. No, it's because you have the answer. You're abiding in the answer, the remembrance of reality, which is what works. And the ego doesn't want that. And of course the ego will paint a pie in the sky saying, okay, if you think you're blissful now, wait, you know, wait, all you got to do is drop that, don't get stuck there, and go on to the higher bliss, you know. And so those who drop this, then they spend the rest of their lives struggling for this higher bliss, they never get it. They say, well, what happened? I guess I need another lifetime. No, they've been scammed by the ego. And meanwhile, their energies are turned towards building an opulent lifestyle for the guru, because the guru again wants to make perception permanent, make this world its permanent home. So they want a bigger, bigger, grander house, grander ashram, grander estate, grander costumes, entourage, flowers, everything. All the efforts of the devotees get turned to that, you see, instead of abiding in vision of effortless equanimity. If they did that, they wouldn't be out there fundraising nonstop for the guru, you know, running up their credit cards for the guru, serving the guru in every possible way to aggrandize their life. They wouldn't be doing it. They would be abiding in this effortless equanimity, this vision of no-thingness, and they would be sharing with others. They would go out and be sharing with others. They wouldn't be holed up in some, you know, place working feverishly like slaves for the guru. No way. So those who want to have to be aggrandized play this game of saying, yeah, that's great, but there's something higher than that, and you know, you're not accepting the guru's grace if you stay stuck there. You're really turning your back on God. You really want separation, blah 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 blah. Lies of the ego. And we don't have to point out their names because there's always more coming. Forget, it's the ego, you know. The ego has many, will give itself many names to divert you, but it's, and it's really fear of the continuity issues, all. That's all. So we have been saddled with that very badly in these times. This is one of the reasons why we're in such a bad predicament right now, is these liars came on the scene and they inflated what the goal was, making us think that accepting what really works is some kind of inferior product, and that we're foolish and stupid to accept it, and that they have the real product. And so we've been confused and conflicted, like, wow, maybe, you know, I need to chase after that higher product. And that's caused the problem. One of the main reasons that we're still stuck. Because this vision can come to us and we'll say, well yeah, that's fine, but I'm after something better. We don't recognize the utility of it. It's a pragmatic issue. We don't have to know anything about the lineages of this religion, or all the gurus in this religion, or all the subtle divisions of comparative religion, or all the names of different exotic names around the world of other, you know, Japanese, Chinese, Tibetan, Korean, Thai, Sri Lankan, Indian, Malaysian, you know, or African, or, you know, all these different names for stuff, comparative religions. We don't need to know any of that. We don't need to know anything like that. All we have to do is see this vision of effortless equilibrium. We can be completely ignorant of anything else as far as spirituality goes. Totally. This has nothing to do with it. So, these peddlers keep telling us, oh, that's you're aiming too low. That's dumb. That's not enough. You gotta have more than that. And so we have this child, you know, and with us right now, this effortless vision of equilibrium, and we're desperately searching for more. It's a trick. That's the trick of the ego. And I've been aware of this trick my whole life and fuming about it, you know, but it's because nobody wants to be categorized as stupid, you know. But I always felt like, hey, you know, all this stuff, stop it, forget it. There, they can da 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 tell you all this, you know, information. It's, oh yeah. But we're smarter. We're after the big prize. We're not gonna settle for this little just this. There's more, a lot more. No, there isn't. No, there isn't. That's fool's gold. Fool's gold. It's kind of like someone in a gold mine, and somebody finds this gigantic boulder of pure gold, and the other people like look at it and say, you know, well. Hey, that's great, that's great, that's nice you found that. But look down the mine shaft, you know, there's so much other gold down there. And you don't want to just, you found this now, but look how much more you can have. So they go off down the gold mine, and they're hacking away at the tunnel, and they're pulling out little tiny, you know, pebbles, little tiny pebbles of gold, little nuggets, tiny nuggets. And they working feverishly their whole life, and they get a little bag of nuggets, maybe, and they say, look, we're getting more gold. Look, there's so much more. There's so much more. Meanwhile, there's this vast boulder of pure gold, and they leave it behind. That's the folly of the world. They're seeking something extra. They want to be prior to reality, right? That's the whole desire, be prior to reality. So here's this remembrance of reality, and they say, well, that's great, but we want to be prior to reality. So. That's the booby prize. It's not really that good. Anyone who chooses it is really stupid. You know, that's the meta message that's been going out in this world forever. Is that somehow those who accept the remembrance of reality, which is the big prize, somehow the meta message is those people are really stupid. They're attached or something, you know. There's all this pejorative underlying message for anyone who does that. The ego set it all up. And so, of course, that hurts us, you know. We feel like, I don't want to have everyone view me as inferior, stupid, settling for, you know, for less than we can have and all this stuff. So that causes, that's the real problem. That is the strongest, well, the continuity problem is the real problem. But this is a dynamic of the ego, which deflects us from the resolution. So it's a severe, severe dynamic. So we have to keep bringing this to light, bringing it to light, because it's what stands in the way, is we don't want to seem to be foolish to others. Others will laugh at us, mock us. And Jesus said you'll be mocked, right? Mock, laugh, spit. What an idiot. I mean, telling everybody they can stop there when that's just a halfway house. We want the whole thing, you know. Okay. Now, what they want is they want to be prior to reality. So that's why they don't want to settle for remembrance of reality. That's the fact. And they're the ones that are foolish. This is what happens when you are solemn and sober. You're able to see this kind of stuff more and more clearly. And you say, oh my gosh, that is true. Cinderella is a perfect story of that. The stepdaughters, that they're saying, ah, we're going for the big prize. You know, Cinderella, she doesn't realize her true worth. She's kind of retarded. She's willing to settle, you know, for less kind of thing. But then she ends up with the prince. Remembering reality is what happens to her, you see. The remembrance of reality comes, and then the prince says, ah, you're one who has remembered reality. So the stepdaughters are you know, desperately trying to get more, because they want to be prior to reality. So it remains to be seen how effective this is, but interestingly enough, the dynamic for us is we already have this vision within us. What we're pursuing, madly pursuing, is something more. This capability to perceive no perception, as it were, vision of emptiness, is already within us. We already have this. But again, we overlook it, and we're trying to get more than that. So really, the spiritual path really is to relax those efforts to try to get more than that, and to accept what's already on our plate. It's like we have this perfect supper, and we're outside, you know, in the forest searching for more, like, and we're starving. And we say, my gosh, we already have a full plate. And of course the ego is going to play that card as much as possible, like, oh boy, you may be happy now, the ego say, but you're going to be really left behind soon, because we're going on the next steps. This is just one rung on the ladder, and there's so many other rungs, and you're just going to be left behind. That's, the ego's going to hit you with that for sure. So it's kind of what I feel going through is just trying to get past this frustration with that dynamic, you know. Because we already have this capability. It's within us. It's put there by God. And we have this way to be perceptually reminded of reality. We already have it. It's not anything we have to attain or search for. We already have it. We just need to end the search for something more. In other words, call off the search. We already have the remedy. We're just not taking it. Because the ego's told us that only losers take that remedy. Only losers, second place finishers, take that. The ego says it has a way to realize the highest. The highest that the ego's really gunning for is being prior to reality. That's what it's really aiming for. There's no such place, no such position. But it claims that's what's driving it, a desire to be prior to reality. So it says, oh, you settle for second place, ha ha ha. We're going for first place, you loser, you know, like that. And look at all this stuff, the ego says. Look at all this subtleties we have. We're working on all this stuff, and wow, you know, you're just a loser. You're just abiding in this vision, and you're missing out on so much more advancement, stuff like that. So it hits you like that. And so we feel shamed into not using what we already have. And that's why the real gurus will say, like Punjabi said, call off the search. Stop the search. You already have it. Stop the search right now. Longchenpo, you know, stop your trying. Give up your trying. Give up your practice. Give up your meditation. Give up your beliefs. You know, stop it. No more, no more, no more. It's already here. It's already here. You already have it. That's the real teaching. That's the real teaching. You already have it. You already have what you need. Don't listen to the lies of the ego saying you need something more than that. You don't. So you don't need to climb the mountain. All the stuff that we're told we need to do, we don't need to do any of it. But because we have been so shamed into all this, we do need to have this sober appraisal of it. That is necessary. To recognize that it's not shameful. And it's not stupid. Is reality stupid because it doesn't recognize the claims of whim? That's really what they're saying. Reality's really stupid. It hasn't yet recognized the claims of whim, but someday it will have to. We'll force it to. That's what the ego's really saying, that it's going to be able to force recognition of the claims of whim. It'll force recognition upon reality at some point. So it's gloating about that, always gloating about it. And so there's all these people trying to recognize some, you know, higher state than remembrance of reality. And these higher states can be given infinite variations and names, and you could struggle through it forever. It's all a delaying tactic, actually. It's all a delaying tactic. A little bird has got a nest right here, apparently. Yeah. Oh, yeah, very nice. So I say these videos are like putting on the brakes. And it hits hard because we have all this momentum, like, I need to study more and more and more and get more wise. I'm not smart enough. And you hit the brakes and say, no, I already have what I need. It's within me. I just need to let go of all these efforts, actually. Because this vision will dawn upon us when we are willing to accept it and not be driven into panic. You see, when you're shamed into thinking that this is settling for second place, when remembrance of reality, the vision of Christ is settling for second place, then when it starts to dawn upon you, you'll go, oh my God, this is terrible. I feel like I'm settling for second place. And then you'll panic and you'll freak out, and then you'll get frantically engaged in all these efforts to learn more, higher states. You know, you become then frantically engaged in that. So this vision will not dawn upon us until we see the situation and will not get thrown, panic and get thrown into pursuing these illusionary other goals. Now, what the problem with drugs is you can sort of force something that's similar to it, and then that panics you, and then you get thrown into a lifetime trying to pursue some sort of higher state. Which is why these gurus often use drugs on their devotees. Sex, the same thing. And so the drugs and sex and rock and roll, all of that is used by these gurus, etc., to try and prematurely to scare you, and then you'll end up trying to pursue these higher states, and then they can use you. But the real vision doesn't come until you have seen through the charade of the ego. Love knows, it holds back and says, okay, when you're ready, it will come. It will bloom when you're ready. But doesn't want to scare you into further delay, that is for sure. So I had a momentary glimpse of it this morning. That's fine, it's okay. Let's go to work today. Let's just go to work on recognizing the situation. Problem again is you feel like you'll be all left alone as a loser, and everybody else will laugh at you and say, what an idiot, settling for that. You know, you're better than that. You don't you realize you're so much better than that? You get this stuff. Don't you realize how special you are? And you're settling for this. It's the constant drumbeat we get in the world. Oh, don't settle for that. That's the constant refrain we get as we're young, and we're told you're better than that. And so some of us, when we're young, we have this vision, and we're constantly told that we came into this world to seek something better than that, to grow beyond that immature stage, as if it's an immature stage. Well, if you put it in the context of believing is possibly prior to reality, prior to pure spaciousness, then you could plausibly define it as an immature stage. But since that goal is impossible, that logic is whimsical. It's not logic at all. Calling it an immature stage is an utter whim, actually. But those driven by whim can be quite cruel, actually. Yeah. So then we go chasing after me, which is this desire to be special, to be greater than, you know, attain something greater than the remembrance of reality. And so then we start studying all sorts of spiritual stuff, and I need to, you know, wow, there's people know so much. They know so much about all this stuff. I got a long ways to go, and that wastes your time. So maybe when we're ready for this vision, the real guru appears and helps us out and says, hey, don't worry, I got your back. I don't know, we'll see. That seems to be the way it's playing out for me. That the real guru comes in. And of course, the real guru wasn't welcome before because you say, hey, you're trying to help me get this lower state. These other gurus, they're telling me I can get a higher state if I go with them, you see. So you're kind of like, you don't really want the guru around, the real guru. See how this works? This is how it works. And you can wise up to it. I've spent a lifetime trying to wise up to it, and it's been very tough. But it's there. It's absolutely there. Something to think about. Heavy, simple stuff, but very heavy stuff. I keep wondering, where's my guru? Where's my guru? Where's my true spiritual advisor? Where's the one who really can help me? And that one's just been waiting, knowing that if they tried to come in prematurely, you would reject them and go fleeing for someone else because you think that they're trying to sell you some inferior goods. Where in fact, what they're selling you is what works. How can what works be inferior goods? The other stuff doesn't work, it's just got all this pretty packaging. All this pretty packaging, but it doesn't work. So what is inferior? We're not talking about packaging, we're talking about what actually works. It's kind of like you're at the gas pump and you're pumping gas in the car, and someone comes up to you and says, hey, you know, I see you're pumping gas in the car. You know, this octane in this car, this gasoline, it's not good. The detergent levels, this. No, he says, I got a much superior blend than this gasoline. Way, way, way better, I'm telling you. And on and on, they'll tell you like a million things about their gasoline, why it's better. And they say, stop. I got this better gasoline for you. And you say, really? He says, yeah, where? He says, well, it's at my place. It's my place, right over down the road there. Just follow me, and I'll. So you say, okay. You stop gassing up your car, or maybe you haven't even begun yet. You haven't even begun. So this person interrupts you before you begin, and you go down the road, and you get to their place, and okay, I'll say, okay, where's the gasoline? He says, well, we got the gasoline, but it's so precious, it's so valuable, it's so superior, that you've got to show yourself worthy of this gasoline, okay? So I say, what do I need to do to get this gasoline? They say, well, you got to help out here. Everybody's helping out here. Oh, okay. So okay, you need to do this. You need to do this, and say, you know what? I want to remodel my house. I want to change this area of my estate. I want to market my gasoline. I want to do this and this and this. And so you end up doing all this work nonstop, hardly eating at all, sleeping at all. You're working so hard, and you're aggrandizing this person so much. And you say, every day you say, hey, I, you know, can I have some gasoline? They say, you're almost there. But first you need to extol the virtues of this gasoline, you know. And so on and on and on and on and on and on and on they go. And the upshot is you never get the gasoline because it's not there. All the while, all you had to do was pump the gasoline at the gas station and your car would get gassed up and you're good to go. Meanwhile, your car's on empty. You can't go anywhere. And you spent your lifetime working for the salesman or sales lady, aggrandizing their castle and their estate and their name and their brand. And you never get any gasoline because they don't have any. It was all just a trick. And of course, those who are tricked by this, they don't want to admit it. So we're helping them see this, that this is all based on the continuity issue and fear of the continuity issue. And it happens to just about everybody. At some point, you go through this. I've been delayed my whole life, so you go through this. But once you see through it, that's it. Well, see, once you go through, you see through it, and it's curtains for all of the ego, really. So don't shrink from it, you know, as far as recognizing the mistakes. Just look at it. Say, okay. That comes from my desire of wanting to be prior to reality. And I'm seeing it. Okay, this is part of the, you know, part of the dance of Maya. I got caught up in it. Now I've had my suffering. I'm tired of suffering for this, and I'm gonna put some gas in my car and be on my way. So you go back to the gas station after you've been conned like this for decades. You go back to the gas station and you feel so ashamed and idiotic, and you go back there, and there's a gas station attendant there that says hi, and they say, "Hi, great to see you. You found out about it, huh? That's great." And you say, "How did you know?" He says, I know this guy comes and tricks, this lady comes and tricks tricks everybody that way. And I said, "Why didn't you say something?" He said, "Well, I couldn't, because you would have felt that you would have developed a negative attitude towards me, thinking that I'm trying to just make a profit off of you by selling you this regular gasoline. And so you wouldn't have come back later, you see. So I had to wait until you saw through the whole charade." And then you say, "Oh my gosh, thanks. And I say, "I feel so stupid." I say, no. This is the ego's highest trick, you see, the highest trick the ego has. And having seen through it, that's it. you've done it. Now gas up, let's gas up." He says, "I'll put the gas in for you, as a matter of fact, you know." And so the real guru then eases your shame. And you know, we say, "Why didn't you speak up?" Because that would have driven us even more into the arms of the false guru, you see. Even more into the arms of the ego, thinking, "Oh, they're trying to deprive me of this higher gasoline. And they're stupid. They don't, you know, they're greedy and they're bad and they're selfish and they're egoic. They're trying to prevent me from getting the better gasoline." All this stuff. And then you would have never gone back to the gas station, you see. It's like that. So, if you can get into this mood of seeing this, then the real guru can appear. You forgive them, you know. You gotta forgive them for that. And that's what I'm going through. I said, why didn't you tell me about this earlier?" And they said, "It would have made things worse." And then I have to accept that's a fact. And then once we can work through this and accept, get to this acceptance, then the real guru can, you know, your pals, absolutely. You don't hold anything against them, you know, and you just realize, wow. Then you got gas in your car and you're good to go, you know. You got a vehicle that works. So we're in a good spot. Anyone who can get to this spot's in a good spot. And listening to this, it's opening your, you know, it's opening the doors to it. It's like saying, oh my gosh, I'm feeling, oh my gosh, that, yeah, I can see that. I know people have been there, I've been there, whatever. Oh my gosh, yeah, there is an answer. I wasn't, you know, I was tricked. I have no reason to be ashamed. You start working through this. You start working through it. Yeah, which is a great thing, great thing. But it takes a little time because, you know, it's like we're like kind of angry. Like, wow, why did I, how come God didn't help me and all this stuff like that. And now you're seeing why. And then you can forgive God, forgive reality, forgive the Holy Spirit, forgive all the gurus, forgive everyone, you know, that we thought should have helped us. Because they know it would have driven us into the arms of this false quest even worse. So, okay. This is a heavy one. They're all heavy. That's the whole idea here. This stuff is heavy. It's profound. It hits hard. We need it. We're running out of time. These projectionists, this whole world thing is getting completely out of hand. It's a Frankenstein monster. So definitely need to come to terms. Forgiveness, acceptance. Forgive yourself. Forgive the guru. Forgive grace. Get gassed up so you can go. All right. Very great. That's it.